سيدنا ومولانا بالقاسم محمد. وعلى آل بيته الطيبين الطاهرين المعصومين المظلومين الذين ذهب الله عنهم الرجس وطهرهم تطهيرا.
اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد.
قال الله الحكيم في كتابه الكريم: بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. والفجر وليال عشر. صدق الله العلي العظيم. Our series of lectures have gone into its fourth night. Tonight is Thursday night. Throughout the week, the most important night is tonight. Tonight is a night of destiny. Tonight is a night of changing your fate. Allah gives you one shot, time and time again. In fact, He's looking for an excuse just to give us. Throughout the year, you have certain times, certain nights. For example, Laylatul Qadr. For example, the night of the 15th of Sha'ban. And week in, week out, Thursday night. The secret of Thursday night is that we have been given one more opportunity to call the Imam back again. And every Thursday night, the Imam is waiting and is looking at your amal, and he's waiting for you essentially to change so that internal revolution takes place. What better month and what better week than in this week to change yourself, that internal revolution to take place. Inside of you, there is turmoil, there is a revolution taking place. As the Quran says, لَقَدْ خَلَقْنَا الْإِنسَانَ فِي كَبَدٍ. There seems to be turmoil, not just in the external world, but within yourself as well. You find when you look deep inside of yourself, there is a Yazid which is fighting, and there is a Hussein which is fighting. And the Hussein inside of you should be the one victorious. In the same way, there is a consciousness which we call Sayyida Zainab inside, which tells you what is right from wrong and emphasizes that right. Make sure the Hussein inside of you wins, because within your fitrah, within the fitrah of man, you've been created to go towards goodness. This is what tonight is about. That night where you change your destiny. That night where you change the course of history. If you are here today, it's because of a reason. And that reason is that you are here to give condolences to Sayyidul Shuhada and to his mother. If you are here today, therefore, it's because you've been invited here. There are many people who may not have made it, but today you are the lucky people who have made it. That tells us that you are a living nation. That tells us that we are a moving nation. But as you come here, there are hundreds of problems that you have in your life, in your mind. In the last couple of days, many people have phoned: health problems, family problems, job problems, university problems, all sorts of things. And as we sit here today, each one of us has some issue, some problem that we need to overcome. What is tonight about then? Tonight is about connecting with Allah so you can remove all of your problems. The heavens are open, and Allah is saying at this time of night, especially after Maghrib, He says to the people, He says, "O people of the world, is there anyone to ask me for something?" And it's tonight that we supplicate to our Lord. It's tonight where we ask our Lord, says Allah, all of these problems, all of the doors have closed. Haven't you seen in your life? Haven't you gone from door to door when a problem befalls you, and may this problem never befall you? But many of our community members, when that problem befalls us, where do they go? They go to their brothers and their brothers turn them away. They go to their sisters and their sisters don't have time for them. They go from door to door asking people for help until that final moment. Imagine if your child is ill. Imagine if you don't have money to take that child to the hospital. What happens? You go from door to door looking for somebody. Is anybody going to help me? What about those orphans in Karbala today? What about those widowers in Syria today? Who do they have to help them? They don't have anyone. We're sitting smug here when there are people suffering over there. Who's there to help? Imagine if that problem came to you. Where do you go? You don't have enough money to support your family. You go from door to door. People shut their doors. What happens? Eventually broken-hearted, where do you go? Eventually you come here to the majlis of Sayyidul Shuhada, and at this moment you raise your hands and you say to Allah, "I've been to every single door, everyone's turned me away, but God, if you turn me away, there is no other creator that I can go towards." It is tonight where you put your hands up and you say, Allah, if you don't help me, who's going to help me? Where am I going to go? Where am I going to turn? This is why in a tradition it says, in a riwayat it says when the most wretched man, a man who's done all of those evil deeds, committed all the sins, when the most wretched man in the world comes in front of his creator, and when he realizes the only thing, the only entity that can help me is Allah. And at that moment, he raises his hands to the skies and he says, Ya Ghaffar. You know what Allah says to the angels? He says, don't answer this person because he's a sinner. He's committed sins. Many sins, don't answer him. But that man persists. In our tradition, it says, persist. Continue to say it. Again, he says, Ya Ghaffar. And again, Allah says, that man is a sinner. Angels don't answer him. But when the third time that man persists again, and he says, Ya Ghaffar, at that moment Allah says to the angels, says, answer him. Angels say, why? He's a sinner. Allah says, because he has no other Lord but me. What door is he going to go to if I don't fulfill his hajat tonight? Tonight, each one of us are here as sinners. Allah, we sit here, but we raise our hands to you in faith. We raise our hands to you believing that you'll answer us. They say in Samara, in the Sardab, a man was going there, and as he went there, at night time there was no one there, but when he went down he saw that the master of the times was in sajda lying there. This man stops, he freezes, and he sees the master of the times is crying. And so he listens to what the master of the times was saying. Your imam is speaking to his creator. What do you think the imam prayed for? What do you think he's praying for? Praying for himself? Listen to this and see what he's praying. Tears are flowing from his eyes and he's saying to Allah, Allah, forgive them. Who? Says, my Shia. Allah, forgive them. If they've committed a sin, forgive their sins. And Allah, forgive them because we are happy with them. Allah, forgive their sins. And then he says again, he says, and Allah, if they have committed sin, now the imam takes it on himself. He says, it's because of us. Why? Because they have faith in us that we will seek intercession for them. So Allah, it is their confidence in us. This is why they committed sin. The imam is making excuses for us. He says, Allah, forgive them because they have faith in us, because they feel that we'll forgive them. They become complacent. They commit a sin, but they have full faith that we will intercede for them. So Allah, forgive them for our sake. That's what the imam is saying. Imagine that. Your imam in a ghaibah at the moment. You know where he is tonight? My heart tells me he's everywhere. Who knows if he's in this majlis? They say in the tradition, you won't know who the imam is, but the imam is watching you. It is our belief that the minute a majlis starts, Zahra comes to that majlis. Who knows if the 12th imam is here today? Imagine if the 12th imam was watching you, what would you do? Imam prays for us. We have one night. The secret behind this night is Fajr time. What happens at Fajr time? Look into the tradition and see. You find that at Fajr time, a voice will come, and that voice will be Jibreel. And he will say to the Mahdi, now it's time to dhuhr. Qad dhahara Mahdi ala Muhammad. That moment, each one of us are waiting. We can change our destiny. We can change our futures. We can change the pain and suffering which we have in our lives. But for one night, connect. And there are many people here. You know that pain that's inside of your chest that each one of us harbors? Open your chest up tonight and appeal to Allah if it's your final night. Amir al-Mu'mineen says, he says, when you do dua in a way that if it's your final night. What is the greatest action you can do on a Thursday night? Go back to that tradition of Amir al-Mu'mineen. You ready for this tradition? Let me tell you this tradition. This tradition is generally recited on the 15th of Sha'aban. The night was the night of 15th of Sha'aban. Amir al-Mu'mineen is sitting in Masjid al-Kufa. And as he sits there, all of his companions are gathered there. And Imam says to his companions, this is a holy night. This is a night where your qadr can change, your destiny can change, your naseeb can change. Everything can change on this night. But Amir al-Mu'mineen says, do this amal and do this and this. But he says, there is one amal, there is one practice of ours, which is the greatest of all of these practices. But you know what? I'm not going to tell you these practices because you're not ready for these practices. You're not ready for that. Who is this? The companions of Amir al-Mu'mineen. Who is the Imam saying it to? His companions. He's saying to them, you are not ready for this amal. Now go back to the sixth Imam alayhi salam, and as he's sitting there in Medina, his companions come to him and they say, Mawla, tell us those secrets. Tell us that sirr ilahi. You know what the Imam says? He says, you are not ready for that sirr. Those companions reply to the Imam. They say, but Amir al-Mu'mineen's companions were taught the secrets by Amir al-Mu'mineen. You know what the Imam replies? He says, yes, because they were sahib sirr. The difference between them was that when we would tell them something, when the Imam would tell them something, they would not tell anybody else. The sixth Imam's companions say, Mawla, we don't tell anybody. The sixth Imam then replies, he says that even when you think about it, the jinns can pick up. Amir al-Mu'mineen's companions were such that when it went in such a way that nobody had access to that. Now look at this. What is the Imam saying? He's saying, I can't tell you these things because you're not ready for these things. The companions go quiet, they pray, and then they go. And at that moment when Amir al-Mu'mineen stands up and he begins to walk, a companion comes behind him and he says, Ya Amir al-Mu'mineen, now tell me what that sir is. Who is that person? That person was Kumail. And as Kumail comes to Amir al-Mu'mineen, Imam says to him, listen, you're not ready for this secret. This secret is something that you can't even contain. You know what Kumail does? He says, Master, please tell me. You know what Amir al-Mu'mineen replies? Who is Amir al-Mu'mineen? Bab al-Rahma. Allah's Rahma comes from Najaf, comes from Amir al-Mu'mineen. Amir al-Mu'mineen says to him, he says, listen, you're not ready for it, but because you are insisting, I'll tell you this secret. What does that mean? That's a lesson for all of us. Sometimes we pray to Allah and our dua doesn't come true. What happens? Continue to knock. There's a tradition that says, it says you continue to knock, don't give up. If in the first 3 weeks your dua is not accepted, keep on knocking on the door, because know that when Allah, what does Allah do? He says to his angels, he says, my servant is knocking, I enjoy when he supplicates to me. So the angels say, when are you gonna answer his prayers? He says, let's see how persistent he is. Persist and you'll see your destiny changes. In the same way as Maysar comes to the sixth Imam alayhi salam, Imam al-Sadiq alayhi salam. Says, this is part of my naseeb. Mawla's been destined for me like this. What can I do? I'm going to die, let's say, for example, within a week. Imam says, Maysar, don't you know dua breaks naseeb? Raise your hands to Allah and do not give up in the rahmah of Allah. Why don't you raise your hands tonight? Tonight is the best night to raise them. Don't think that you'll think sitting in bar first. Think that you are facing the arsh of Allah. Think that this is your final chance. What would you do if today is your final? How would you cry to Allah when you go into sajda? The world thinks that you're crazy, but you know that you are connecting with your Lord. At that moment, Amir al-Mu'mineen says, he says, you're not worthy of this, but you know what? I'll still give it to you. Why? Because you're persistent. Dua breaks naseeb. Before I tell you what Kumail was given, understand this. It says dua, the power of dua. Where does it come? Amir al-Mu'mineen is coming in front of the fort of Khaybar, the Prophet of God says. And if you look at that tradition, 39 days had gone. The Prophet of God says, on the 40th day, we will win Khaybar over. 39 days have gone. The companions have gone. The companions have come back. Khaybar has not been victorious. What's going to happen here? The Prophet of God on the 39th day, and the second Khalifa says this, and you'll find this within tradition. He says, I envy Ali for three reasons. One of them was the Prophet of God gave him the flag at Khaybar. So what happens here? 39th night, coming into the 40th, Rasulullah says to the people, he says, O people, tomorrow I'm going to give this flag to a man who Allah loves, and he loves Allah. He will not run away from the battlefield. The second Khalifa said, he said, all night I couldn't sleep because I was excited. The suspense was too much. It was tickling my stomach. All night I was thinking, when, who, how? Says at Fajr time when I got up, I went towards Amir al-Mu'mineen. Sorry, I went towards Rasulullah. And when I went towards Rasulullah, I asked him, who is this person? And at that moment, what happens? That moment, Rasulullah says, Salman, Abu Dharr, get ready. Your Mawla is coming. Rasulullah stands there, looks towards Medina, and he recites, Nadir Aliyan Maghar al-Ajayb. Amir al-Mu'mineen comes. Now, you know when people ask you, why do you say Ya Ali? It's because Rasulullah said Ya Ali. This is Amir al-Mu'mineen. Ayatollah Abdul Karim Kashmiri says, student of Sayyid Ali Qadhi, studied together with Allama Tabatabai, very big alim, marja. You know what he says? He says, in Najaf, whenever I had a problem in my life, I would go to the Sahan of the Haram of Amir al-Mu'mineen and seven times I would recite Nadi Ali and my problem would be solved. But again, he has a different formula to the one that's in the market. And if you want, you can go into the books and find out what that formula is. It's very small, there's only three lines. He says that whenever I had a problem, I used to recite Nadi Ali seven times and it would come true. Amir al-Mu'mineen, Madhar al-Ajayb. Look into tradition and see. Imam himself, when he talks about himself, it's amazing when he talks about himself. He says that I was with Adam when Adam repented, and I was with Ibrahim when Ibrahim was being chucked into the fire, and I was with Musa when he went in front of the Pharaoh, and I was with Isa when they were coming after him, sirran, but I was with the Prophet sirran wa jahran. That's Amir al-Mu'mineen. And you know, people ask, they say, how is it possible that Amir al-Mu'mineen was there with Adam when Amir al-Mu'mineen came at the end? The solution is very simple. It's a great philosophy, inshallah. If we get 45 minutes, I'll explain to you the whole system. But in a nutshell is this. Amir al-Mu'mineen is what? When the Prophet of God's light was created, all of creation and the angels were created from the light of the Prophet. What is also a creation? Time is also a creation. The physical world is also a creation. Go and ask any philosopher, what is time? It's motion. The physical world is in motion. That's what creates time. So when people ask, was there a time that Allah was alone? Time in itself is a physical creation. Go above the physical world, and what you find is that time ceases to exist in the way it happens in the physical world. This is why Mir Damad looks at three types of time. He says Zaman, Daher, Sarmad. He has a different system of time, and this is philosophy, and we can look at it some other time. But the fact is, time in itself is a physical reality. What is Amir al-Mu'mineen then? He contains all of creation inside of himself because he's the perfect man. From azal ta abad, from the time of the beginnings where there is no beginning, and until the end where there is no end, Amir al-Mu'mineen contains all of that. That's why in Khutbatul Bayani he says, Ana awwal wa akhir, zahir wa batin. Amir al-Mu'mineen, from the beginning of creation to the end of creation, all of reality, including time, is in within him. That's why when we talk about Adam, the sir of Adam is Ali ibn Abi Talib, and the sir of Nuh is Ali ibn Abi Talib, and the sir of Ibrahim and Musa and Isa, until the final prophet you find, that sir is Ali ibn Abi Talib. This is why when you go to the Torah, or when you go into the Bible, you find that whenever a prophet had a problem, he would call Aliya. Who is Aliya? No one has claimed to be Aliyah. Only one person has. You go into tradition, people have claimed to be the Messiah. You go into tradition, you find that people have claimed to be the Prophet. But no one within history has claimed to be Aliyah. Only in the Battle of Khaybar you find. One man goes in front of the fort and he says, oh, Jews, I am the Aliyah that's been predicted in the Torah. I am the Aliyah in the Bible. I'm Ali ibn Abi Talib. So in this way, yeah. So in this way, that when Amir al-Mu'mineen comes in front of the forts of Khaybar, and as he comes there, in the tradition it says that there was a Jew standing, he was a Najumi. He was standing at the top of the fort. He says to Marhab, he says, Marhab is your lucky day today, because today you'll beat Ali ibn Abi Talib. He says, why? He says, because the stars are in alignment today. Mawla hears this, he smiles. He takes his flag and he hits it in the rock. Says the rock breaks and the flag goes in. The Najumi looks up at Marhab, he says, don't worry, that was a fluke. Imam smiles, he takes a step back again and he hits it again and it breaks. At that moment, the Najumi says, don't go and fight this man, because this man has a knowledge that nobody does. If you're going to fight him, he'll kill you. Battle of Khaybar, and in the same way, in the Battle of Siffin, when Amir al-Mu'minin is coming to fight against Muawiyah, another Najumi comes. He says, Ali, the stars are against you today. If you were to fight, you'll lose against Muawiyah. Amir al-Mu'minin looks at him and he says, look, we rely only on Allah. Hasbunallah wa ni'mal wakil. You'll see how we win. Says Amir al-Mu'minin begins to fight. And as he begins to fight, at the end of the Battle of Siffin, Amir al-Mu'minin is victorious. As he comes towards the Najumi, he says, what happened, Najumi? What happened to your power? He says, Ali, what can I do? As you are fighting, the stars were changing. Jupiter was turning. Saturn was turning, the moon was going into another direction. He says, Ali, it was as if the entire universe was moving as you were moving. The power of dua, the power of tawassul, the power of Amir al-Mu'mineen. If you're sitting here today, when you now ask Allah for the sake of the Imam, ask Allah for the sake of Sayyid al-Shuhada, ask Allah for the sake of Zahra. That's what these nights are about. Destiny changes. So here now the Imam, now come back. Here the Imam now says, he says, Kumail, I'm going to teach you something. You know what I'm going to teach you? I'm going to teach you the dua of Khidr. That when Khidr would recite this, the ground would cry. And he begins and he says, but memorize this. And then tell my Shia this dua. What was this dua? Tell my Shia, recite it once in your lifetime. And if you can't, in fact, he says, recite it every week on a Thursday. If not, once a month. If not, once a year. If not, once in your lifetime. If not, just listen to it. What was this Dua Khidr? Today you call it Dua Kumail. The secret of that you don't understand. You see, the problem is that we're given these jewels that we take lightly. I remember many years ago, right? Many years ago within Sayyida Zainab itself. See, many of the Syrians who were Wahhabi, they wouldn't come there. They wouldn't know what Sayyida Zainab is. So one day we convinced this taxi driver. We said, look, you know what? You've never been to Sayyida Zainab. Why don't you come and just see it for once? The night was a Thursday when he went and Dua Kumail was being played. Within the first 30 seconds, he broke down crying. He says, who is this person reciting this dua that when he recites it, the fear of God comes into my heart. Hope comes into my heart. Who is this that says Allah's mercy is such that encompasses all of creation, breaks you down, honestly. Look at the love of Amir al-Mu'mineen. You know, if we had time, we could analyze one verse by one verse. The secret of Dua Kumail is the secret of the 12th Imam alayhi salam. Powerful, and this is one of those speeches that you do on the 15th of Sha'ban. But if you look at the sirr of that Dua Kumail, you have that power. All of your sins can be wiped out. All of your du'as can be accepted. If not anything tonight, if you have 25 minutes spare, go and sit down in a corner, forget the world, sit down and recite Dua Kumail. Changes your destiny. This is why we're here for, the idea of destiny being changed. As the dhuhr of the Imam comes closer, we're going to need all of these du'as to help us. You see, we have a great power. We don't understand that. You know, if you understood it in the tradition, Imam is saying, if a person was to recite hamd over a dead body, that body would come back to life again. Only if you know the ma'rif of that. Just the bismillah is so powerful. If only you knew what the secret behind the bismillah was, that you can move mountains from its places. It says in the tradition, it says the believer is so powerful that he can remove the mountain from its place, and he can travel in space and time in a blink of an eye. This isn't just something which is said to people. This is a reality. Understand that reality. Know that you have that power to do that. Ahlul Bayt have taught you so many secrets. You just need to go back and understand those secrets. If we were to understand those secrets, let me just give you one more, and then after that, we move on to what our topic was yesterday to finish off what we started yesterday. Sixth Imam alayhi salam says, and you do this every single day, right? Imam Ja'far al-Sadiq alayhi salam is saying, and I give you this tradition only and only out of the love of Zahra alayhi salam. Because in a tradition it says this, Sixth Imam is saying, he's saying that on the day of judgment, he's saying, and I remember hearing this myself from Ayatollah Wahid al-Khurasani, He says, on the day of judgment, and Wahid al-Khurasani in Qum is recognized as A'lam. Says, on the day of judgment, he says that Jibreel will be standing there waiting. Which Jibreel? That Jibreel that doesn't wait for anyone. Adam waited for Jibreel. Nuh waited for Jibreel. Ibrahim waited for Jibreel. Musa waited for Jibreel. Isa waited for Jibreel. Yaqub, 33 years, waited for Jibreel. The Prophet of God waited for Jibreel. That Jibreel will be standing there waiting for someone. He will have a horse and he will be waiting there. Who will he be waiting for? The horse will have a saddle on it. The exterior of the saddle, Afullah. The interior of the saddle, Rahmatullah. He will be waiting. Waiting for who? The Lady of Light to come. And as the Lady of Light comes onto Mahshar, Allah will say, lower your gazes, Fatima bint Muhammad is coming onto Mahshar. And as she comes onto Mahshar, it says in the tradition, it says that when she comes, the sixth Imam is saying, she comes like a bird comes. She will pick one by one, like bird picks up seeds, her Shia. He'll pick you up one by one, the followers. But you know what? On that day, you will feel pride as well. And as you are going into heaven, you will be inspired by Allah. And you will say to Allah, Allah, show our status to the world as well, because we were the lovers of Zahara. Allah will say, in a tradition it says, even if a person has given you a glass of water for the love of Zahara, take all of them and take him into Jannah. Take all of them. Take every single person. It says, bar the munafiq and the polytheist, every single person will be taken to heaven out of the love of Zahra, if you have that love in your heart. So today, when you stand there, or when you give even a glass of water or a cup of chai to your believers, give it with the intention that I'm giving out of the love of Zahra. This is why I'm going to narrate this tradition. What does the sixth Imam say? Sixth Imam says this, my 1,000 units of prayers, my 1,000 units of prayers. Which prayer? Imam al-Sadiq's prayer. His one prayer is worth 1,000 times. In fact, if Amir al-Mu'mineen's one hit of his sword, his verb, one slash of his sword is worth the heavens and the earth's prayer, imagine what Imam Sadiq's two units of prayers is. 1,000 units of prayers, right? In each one of those rakats, you find what? Hamd. So two, multiply that, 2,000 hams. How many sajdas? 4,000. How many rukus? 2,000, right? Prayers. 1,000 units of... Look at the tradition, what it says. 1,000. Imam is saying, my 1,000 units of prayers for one tasbih of Fatima al-Zahra. 34, 33, 33. You have that with you, you underestimate it. You pray your prayers and you run away quickly, you leave quickly, not realizing that if you had the ma'arifah of what you were reciting, 1,000 units of Imam al-Sadiq's prayer, just for that. You have jewels, my friend. It's unbelievable what you have. You know, our Sufi brothers spend 50, 60 years trying to get to reality, trying to go from one sheikh to another sheikh. Sheikh, give me a dhikr. Sheikh, give me this. Sheikh, give me that. Ahlul Bayt turned around and said, whatever you want is found between us. But you see, Ahlul Bayt are giving though. They give things like no other. I want to take you to that tradition. I remember one more tradition, and I'll give you this tradition as well, because today it seems like that all of these secrets are coming out. You know what Amir al-Mu'mineen says, right? They say Salman comes to Amir al-Mu'mineen. He says, Amir al-Mu'mineen, tell us, who is more giving, Hakim al-Tai or you? Imagine that. You know who Hakim al-Tai is? Prophet of God says he will not go into hell. He wasn't a believer. He will not go to heaven, he will not go to hell. There's a middle place where he'll go to. Somebody asked why. He says, because there are certain qualities that Allah likes, he can't put that person in hell. What is that quality? He says, Hakim al-Tai was generous. He gave things. So he gave things. One of the qualities of a believer is that he's not stingy. He gives things. You come to a believer, look at Sayyid al-Shuhada, right? A person comes to his door, knocks on his door. He says, oh person, I'm poor. Give me something. Sayyid al-Shuhada stands up. Barefooted he comes. He says, give me all of the wealth in my house. He takes his abba. He puts it all in. He says he had tears in his eyes. He opens the door, he puts his hand out, and he begins to cry. And then he stops. That person takes it, he opens it, and he bursts out into tears. Sayyid al-Shuhada says, he says, please, I don't have anything else. If I had anything more, I would have given it to you. The person says, I don't cry because of that. He says, you've given me so much that I wonder how a person like you will be buried and how dirt will be put into that person's face. He says, you've given me too much. I just asked you for a small thing. You've given me so much that seven of my generations can live off that food. That's how much you've given. That's Sayyid al-Shuhada. Today, why don't you go to the shrine of Sayyid al-Shuhada? People ask, they say, why should we go to the ziyarah of Sayyid al-Shuhada? This is why you should go to the ziyarah of Sayyid al-Shuhada. In a tradition, it says the Prophet of God is sitting there in Masjid al-Nabawi. A monk comes to him. He says, you claim to be the Rasulullah, the final Prophet of God. He says, I don't have any children. Give me children. Rasulullah looks towards him. He says, it's not within your nasib to have children, but know one thing. There is one solution. He says, what's that solution? He says, that three-year-old boy who's playing over there, if you ask him, maybe he'll give it to you. This is why you should go. When you go for Arbain now, just have this in your mind. You know what happens? This man goes towards him. He says, your grandfather is saying that you can give me a son. They say, Sayyid al-Shuhada sits up with the Jalal of Imamat. And he says, I've given you one son. And then he stops. He says, I've given you two sons. And then he stops. He says, I've given you three sons. And then he stops. I've given you four sons, five, six, seven. A voice comes from behind. That voice says, you've come to Sayyid al-Shuhada. Go away from here. He will not stop giving until you yourself don't go away. Why don't you go to Sayyid al-Shuhada and know that he will not stop? This is why it says in the tradition, that person who goes under the dome of Sayyid al-Shuhada, whatever he asks for will come true. But just understand one thing. Arifan bihaqqih. Have that conviction in your heart. Have that understanding of who Sayyid al-Shuhada is. He will give you everything. If you have within your heart that this is Hussein, he'll finally give you everything. Everything is yours. Until you don't go away, Hussein won't stop. If at 3 years old he could do that, then imagine what he could do today. So remember, when those tears come into your eyes, right? What do you say to Hussein? You say, Sayyid al-Shuhada, if you can give to a non-Muslim, I'm crying over Qasim. Tears are coming in my eyes because of Ali Akbar. Tears are in my eyes because of the broken rib of your mother. Answer my prayer tonight. Each one of us. Prayers breaks destiny. Prayers breaks it. This is what Imam is teaching us. These are the secrets of Ahlul Bayt. Now go back and let's finish that tradition. Hakim At-Tai. He was generous, right? Generosity is something which is a quality in man. They say, Amir al-Mu'mineen says to Salman, Hakim al-Tai was giving. Imam affirms this. But you know what happens? Look in the tradition and see. It says, Hakim al-Tai, right? When he passed away, his son says that I want to be like my father. So he gets up and he comes to the minbar of his father and he sits there. He says, from today, I'm going to be like my father. Grandmother was standing there. She says, son, you cannot be like your father. He says, why? He says, because your father was father from birth. He says, when he was younger, when a child would be crying, he would give his own toys to the child. When you were younger, you'd snatch away the toys from the child. He says, the difference is that your father was born from birth. He was like this. You cannot be like that. He says, watch how I'm like that. They say, Hakim al-Tai had 40 doors. Whenever a person used to knock on one door, he would go to that door, he would give it. Second door, if there was a knock, he would change his clothes, he would go to the second door. This time what happens is that there's a knock on the door, the son gets up, he opens a door, there was an old woman there. The old woman says, can you give me something for the sake of God? He takes whatever he had, he gives it. 5 minutes later, there's another knock. He opens the door. The same woman is there. He goes, woman, I gave you on the first door. She looks up and she says, has Hakim Atai died? I says, why? He says, because I would go to 40 doors. He never turned me away. You know what Amir al-Mu'mineen says? He says, Hakim Atai was giving. But he says, I'm more giving. When a person comes to my door once, they don't need to go to any other door because I give them so much in one go. So now tonight, dua is dua. Amir al-Mu'mineen, Ahlul Bayt. Have we got any better wasila than that? Ahlul Bayt. Ask for the sake of the Ahlul Bayt. If you can have a salawat, please. Another salawat, please.
Allahumma salli ala Muhammad.
Ahlul Bayt. That is our wasila tonight. Thursday night, night of destiny. Thursday night, night of change. Give you another story then. As we're on dua. Ulama have said, and you find within our scriptures, that there are certain awqat, certain times of dua. If you want your dua to become mustajab, there are certain times, ask Allah. You know what one of those times is? 10 minutes before Fajr sets in. They say, Allama Majlisi's father. Allama Majlisi, that person who wrote 110 volumes of Bihar al-Anwar. In that period of time, where it's very difficult to write 500,000 traditions. You know what somebody said? They said, look at your son and how great he is. His father replied, he said, my son is great because of my dua. He says, what dua? He says, 10 minutes before Fajr, I was sitting there thinking to myself, what dua I should do. I looked towards the cradle, my son was there. And at that moment, I said to Allah, make my son a great alim. Allah made him a great alim. 10 minutes before Fajr. If you have a dua today, in tonight, if there is a problem in your life and you want that fulfilled, 10 minutes before Fajr, be on your musalla, go to that place, sit down, raise your hands and say, Allah, for the sake of this time, for the sake of Muharram, for the sake of Sayyidul Shuhada, answer my prayers. One part. Second part, it says that if a person before the Maghrib prayers on a Friday, and this is within our tradition, many people don't know this tradition I'll narrate. It says on a Friday before Maghrib time, what is one of the signs of the Shia? It says in one of our isolated traditions, it says that before Maghrib time, that person who is our follower will give salam to the 12th Imam alayhi salam and then ask for his dua. So if anything, if you don't have a dua, just before Maghrib sets in, tomorrow before Maghrib sets in, give salam to the 12th Imam alayhi salam. Know that this also changes your destiny. Know that when the time of Dhuhr comes in, when it comes in on that precise moment, then raise your hands. Go into our tradition. Allah has left nothing unturned. In the day he's telling you, if your dua is not answered at Fajr time, that it will be answered at Dhuhr time. If not Dhuhr, at Maghrib time. If not at Maghrib, when it comes to Salatul Layl, but at least ask when it comes to Salatul Layl. Again, there's another tradition. That person who recites Salatul Layl, that person for 40 days, you will find that his risk doesn't stop. If you have a problem with your risk, if you are not getting a job, if you are under that financial line, then start reciting Salatul Layl and you'll see that with the Salatul Layl, what happens? Your risk increases. All of the Imams have said at some stage or another, Amir al-Mu'mineen is leaving. When Sayyidul Shuhada was leaving this world, he looks towards Sayyidah Zainab. What does he say? Alaykum bis Salatul Layl. Remember this prayer. Remember me in this prayer. Salatul Layl. We have all of these jewels of the Ahlul Bayt, but what do? We leave them on our libraries. And dirt is coming onto those libraries. Open them. See, sometimes they say when you give something for free, people don't understand it. Understand it. Open it up and say, Ahlul Bayt have given you all of these things. It is then, it becomes our responsibility to utilize these things. Once we've utilized it, only then can we go to the outside world and express to them all of these things. You see, one of the main things is to create that internal revolution inside of yourself. I asked a mujtahid once. I said to him, look, when it comes to the dhuhur of the imam, what should we be doing? Only praying? He says, no, create the dhuhur within yourself. It just doesn't mean prayer. It means becoming active in your community as well. One of those things is becoming active in your community. If you can't take care of your mosque, how are you going to take care of the revolution of the imam? If we have a shortage of volunteers, let's say, for example, if we did, inshallah we don't. But how are we going to facilitate for the coming of that imam when we can't even run our own centers today? You see, if we're going to export the message of Sayyid al-Shuhada, we have to become organized. We have to become structured. It is not just dua, but it's also amal as well. It is action that changes us. Make sure that you are changing yourself. Go outside and see what is the change. As Shias, we require a structure. That structure means we need to make a difference. Today, no one can cry and say, why is the media against us? Why are people against us? Why is it that we're getting bad press? Why don't you stand up and make that difference? Become the need in your society. If we don't have people in media, go into media. If we don't have people in universities, go into universities. If we don't have accountants, become accountants. Become solicitors. Do all of these things. Become the need of a society. There are certain nations which are great today, and the only reason they are great is because they are in need of the society. Even if somebody doesn't like you, but they can't live without you because you are in need of that society, integrate and become one with them. Politics, it is good to be in politics. You know, when a lot of people they ask and they say, well, how can we change what people say? How can we change politicians? Stand up and become that. You have so many people in your own centers that you can do that. Train your children. Because before the coming of the imam, we need to prepare the groundworks. We can't just sit down lazy and prepare, you know, it doesn't happen like that. Get up and change the system. We require politicians. We require people in all forms of life. And people can say, well, isn't it haram to join politics? No, the ulama have said, if you're benefiting your community, Ali ibn Yaktin in this time of the imam was what? In the time of Harun Rashid was the prime minister. The imam says, go in there, benefit the community. You're not just benefiting your community, you're benefiting all communities because you are a Shia. You know what that means? That means you have the teachings of Amir al-Mu'mineen. When you show the world the ethics of Amir al-Mu'mineen and the morals of Amir al-Mu'mineen and the kindness of Amir al-Mu'mineen and that letter, that khutbah, that letter that he writes to Malik al-Ashtar, you find people around you become influenced. This is why you find that whenever our followers, the imam is saying, become our zina, right? Become our beauty. Don't become someone who we look at and we feel remorse towards. Become somebody who's our zina. Today, it's our opportunity to make that difference. It is the responsibility of each Shia to make that difference. If people are dying within Syria, if the shrine, and you saw that clip, Sayyida Zainab, this is a group within London, right? And if I was to tell you about this group, they're one family, right? Mother and daughter, two sons. They made an entire difference. 500 people coming to a university, listening to this, 5-6 different TV channels, all of your famous lecturers within London, right? All of them are taking part within this in the UK. Why? Because a family makes, if one family, imagine if all of these people here, thousands of people who are here today, if each one of you stood up and said, we're going to make that difference, we're going to lobby our politicians, we're going to lobby government, what happens? From Damascus, a woman will raise her hand and say, Allah, they are trying for my sake. Allah, you help them. Don't you want to say that Zainab does? Is it going to benefit me? No, it's going to benefit the system. It's going to benefit the people. It's going to benefit Imam. Remember, imagine the Imam. Imagine Sayyid al-Shuhada. When he looks at you supporting his sister, when he looks at you supporting the oppressed, when he sees you standing up against the oppressors, whoever they are in the world, whatever they are, however they are, even if they're Muslim, stand up against oppression. What was Yazid in terms of visually? He was the Khalifa of the what? Muslims. What was Hussein? He stood up and he said, that person is wrong. What am I going to do? Islah. I'm going to reform the system. Reformation is required. Stand up and reform the system. That's what Muharram is about. Muharram is a revolution. It's a revolution to reform the system. It wakes up the conscious. Wakes up your conscience. Wake it up. Wake it up. Become selfless. You see, no one thing. If you go after fame, you won't, even if you get it, right? You won't get the ultimate reward, which is peace and satisfaction. Become selfless and you find the whole world comes in front of you. These are what these nights are about. But you know what? You're here to cry tonight. you had to shed those tears. Yesterday we were in Medina. Today I want to take you to Kufa. I want to take you to Najaf. Imagine if you're sitting in front of Amir al-Mu'mineen tonight. And again, zone out. You see, the physical body is here, but the soul travels, right? Zone out. Yesterday you heard the musibah of Zahra. You know what today comes into my mind? They say in the Battle of Siffin, Amir al-Mu'mineen was crying. Somebody asked him, they said, "Ya Amir al-Mu'mineen, why are you crying for?" He says, "Because the pain of Zahra is still within my chest." Go to that khutbah 202 of Nahj al-Balagha. If you don't believe me, go to the khutbah. You know what the Imam says? In the Battle of Hunain, the Imam didn't say this. In the Battle of Siffin, the Imam didn't say this. Which Imam? That Imam who is the victor. In front of all of his enemies, the Imam never said this. But there was one time where he said, "My back is broken." What was that time? When he took the body of Zahra and he was burying her. He says, "My back is broken." He says, "I don't want to live anymore. Without her, I don't want to live anymore. My soul is coming out of my chest. My back is broken." That was that moment. Amir al-Mu'mineen, imagine what he's saying there. They say that there are three people in the world who, when giving ghusl and kafan, cried. One of them was Amir al-Mu'mineen. You know what Imam says? He says, nighttime. He says, how he must have been feeling. He says, "The Lady of Lights, I'm burying her at nighttime." Nighttime when there's no one there, nighttime. He gave ghusl at night and kafan at night and burial at night. Ulama were asked, why is it that Ali was told by Zahra to give her ghusl and kafan at nighttime? An alim replied, he said the reason was that she was hiding the fact that her rib was shattered and her eye was bruised and her face was beaten. There was a slap mark on her face. That mark was still there. Says Amir al-Mu'mineen waited until nighttime. Zahra waited because she didn't want the Imam to see that. They say as he was giving ghusl and kafan to her, her hand was on her chest. Her hand was on her chest. Imam says, "Zahra, why don't you remove your hand? You know water has to come here as well." They say when Zahra removed her hand, and as he saw the broken rib of Zahra, he starts hitting his head on the wall and he starts crying. Fidda said, says, "Ali, why are you crying for Abul Hassan? Why are you crying for?" Says, "Zahra hid it for me. Zahra hid it for me. 90 days, her rib was broken. Every time she breathed in, every time it would pain her and hurt her. She didn't tell me that her rib was broken." May Allah accept your tears. Pray for the other people as well. All of those people who are suffering. It says in a tradition, when you pray for other people, Allah accepts your du'as. Second person, you know who that second person was? Imam al-Baqir alayhi salam. They said after 34 years after Karbala, when Imam Zain al-Abidin, when he was giving ghusl and kafan, they say when he turned him on his back, he saw the slash marks on his back. He began to cry and say, "Father, you're still in pain. Look at your back. Look at the way that is broken. Look at these marks on your back." But they say the third person was Imam Zain al-Abidin, Imam Sajjad himself. You know when he cried? He cried in Sham. At what point did he cry in Sham? When there was ghusl and kafan being given to Sakina. They said that when he looked at the body of Sakina, right? They say there's a parallel between Zahra and Sakina. You know what that parallel is? Zahra's rib was shattered. Sakina, all of her ribs were shattered. They say Zahra had a slap mark on her face. They say Shimmer used to slap Sakina as well. They said that Sakina's ears were bleeding. They said that Sakina's body was blue. They said that when a body burns, right, her clothes burnt into her skin. Her skin and her body was one. They said that when Imam Zain al-Abidin was giving ghusl and kafan, when he looked at the white hair of Sakina, after that he grabbed the body, he looks towards the grave. You know when a person's being buried, a mahram comes into the grave, right, to bury it. They say there was no mahram for Sakina. He looks towards Karbala. He says, "Father, your amana was preserved when you gave it to me. Father, when I'm putting it in the grave now, that amana is shattered, Father." Ajurkum Allah. May Allah accept your prayers. Today you are giving condolences to who? Sayyid al-Shuhada. Take a breath, because you can't cry like Imam Zain al-Abidin. Believe me. Only Imam Zain al-Abidin can continuously cry. You can't cry. Your tears will come to an end. His tears won't come to an end. When people ask, why did you cry blood tears, right? If you were to see Sakina like this, what would you do? You know she's still alone today? You know the terrorists have attacked her grave? News is coming, right? They've attacked her grave. They've demolished that sahan which is there. Say that Zainab is still protected, right? But this is within Damascus. She's still alone today. You can still hear that crying today. She's calling for her father. One poet said, in Halat-e Kashf, right? You know what he sees? He says the 12th Imam comes to the grave of Sakina and he sits next to the grave of Sakina and he recites in the words of Sayyid al-Shuhada a lullaby to Sakina so that Sakina doesn't feel that she's alone there. He says, I'm with you. He says, I'm with you. Now go back and say, you know what tonight is about? Tonight is about Hur. Tonight is about Hur. You know who that Hur is? That Hur who took Sayyid al-Shuhada to his death. That Hur. They say that as Hur came and intersected Sayyid al-Shuhada, intersected him, afterwards he says, my people are thirsty. I have 1,000 men, they're thirsty. You know Sayyid al-Shuhada did? He didn't say, I don't have enough water. He takes the water with his own hands of imamat and he gives it to each one of the soldiers. And then after that, he gives each one of the horses as well. And then afterwards, you know what happens? The time comes of prayer. You know what Sayyid al-Shuhada says to Hur? He says, Hur, why don't you lead your prayers and I'll lead my prayers. You know what Hur says? He says, you are the grandson of the Prophet. You are the son of Zahra. I want to pray behind you. After praying behind him, right? Hur says, now I'm capturing you and I'm taking you. As he raised his voice, Sayyid al-Shuhada with tears in his eyes looks towards Hur. He says, Hur, lower your voice. My sister is behind me. He says, if she was to hear you, she'd start crying. They said in the tradition, it says the women start crying when they hear Hur shouting at Sayyid al-Shuhada's voice raised. Sayyid al-Shuhada says, may your mother be deprived of you. Why did he say that? To awaken Hur. You know what Hur says? He says, I would have insulted you as well, right? I would have given you a reply. But what can I do? Your mother is Zahra. It says, as the tents now, second of Muharram comes, right? The tents are there. Hur comes up to us, Sayyid al-Shuhada. He says, remove all of those tents and take them away from the Farat. In the tradition, it says, Sayyid al-Shuhada doesn't go to Ali Akbar or Qasim or anybody else. He goes to Abbas of all people. That Abbas who's waiting to fight. Imagine Abbas when, you know what happens? He goes to Abbas and he says, Abbas, why don't you remove all of the tents? Now imagine Abbas, what he would have done. He says, Sayyid al-Shuhada, he says, Mawla, I'm not weak. If you want, I can kill these people. I can take revenge. I can take all of these guys out. He says, no, remove the tents. He says, with tears in his eyes, because Abbas knows what his power is, he removes all of the tents and he shifts them away. Third day goes, fourth day goes, seventh day goes, water stops, ninth night comes. On the ninth night, Mas'ab comes towards Hur. He says to Hur, I'm going outside. Hur says, why are you going outside for? It's so hot. He says, because my animal is thirsty. That's why I'm going outside. At that moment, he stops and Hur listens and he hears these small voices of a small girl coming from far away, which is saying, Al-Atash. Says, I'm thirsty. He could hear, Father, I'm thirsty. Father, I'm thirsty. Hur is hearing this. Hur turns around and there's a revolution that now takes place within his heart. You know what Hur turns around and says? Hur looks at his son. He says, son, my heart is wrenching. He says, why, father? He says, because I'm between heaven and hell. I don't know which way to go, but my heart is telling me I need to go to heaven. You know what his son says? His son says, where is heaven, father? He says, heaven lies with Hussein. He says, now let's go. They say that a slave was sitting there and he says, Hur, if you're going, take me as well. Mas'ab says, take me as well. But you know what Hur says to his son? He says to his son, son, you know what? Why don't you tie my arms behind my back when you take me? Son says, why? He says, because these were the hands that grabbed the horse of Sayyid al-Shuhada. He says, tie my hands behind. And he says, why don't you close my eyes as well? Tie my eyes. He says, why, father? Because I looked in ghadab towards Sayyid al-Shuhada. He says, tie my eyes as well. And he says, what else? He says, tie me and take me towards Hussein. As he was going towards Hussein, Hur's son says, he says, Abul Fadl al-Abbas is coming. You know what he does? He drops himself onto the ground. But Abbas says, he says, Hur, you're my guest today. And he takes him towards Sayyid al-Shuhada. And as he takes him towards Sayyid al-Shuhada opens up his arms. He opens up his eyes. You know what Hur says? He says, forgive me, Mawla. You know what Sayyid al-Shuhada says? He says, my mother has forgiven you and I have forgiven you. Imagine that. All of that taking who? Sayyid al-Shuhada towards his death. It says in the tradition, he says, Mawla, I have one request. He says, what is that? He says, let me go and give my life life first. But you know what it says in the Maqdal, right? Listen to this. You know what it says. He says, when Hur got ready, he goes towards the tent of Zainab. And as he comes to the tent of Zainab, he says, O daughter of the Prophet, O daughter of Zahra, forgive me. I've taken your brother to his death. But if not, don't do one thing. On the day of judgment, don't complain to your mother about me. Know that I've come to you to seek for forgiveness. Say that Zainab says, I forgive you. As Hur turns around, Hur looks towards his son. He says, son, I want to see your body come back first before my body. They say Hur's son attacks. After a little while, a noise comes. And that noise says, father, I've been hit. I'm falling, father. They say Hur doesn't know what to do. He runs towards his son. And as he runs towards his son, what does he see? He sees Sayyid al-Shuhada sitting there with his son. He looks towards Hur. Hur says, Sayyid al-Shuhada, why have you come? Hur replies, he says, because a father never comes, an old father never comes to the body of his young son. Now let me ask you, what's going to happen in a couple of days' time when we're sitting here? I can't narrate this, but you know what? Sayyid al-Shuhada comes running like this. Hur is sitting there. Now imagine that time that comes when a father, broken, backed, blinded, is holding onto the ground and he's saying, son, call me, where are you? Ali Akbar, call me. And they say, Imam Hussein on his hands and knees begins to crawl towards Ali Akbar. Inna lillahi wa inna ilayhi raji'un. For the sake of Muhammad and Ali Muhammad, may Allah accept our prayers, accept our worship, accept our amal. One time comes on, one more tradition. Bring your hajat to your mind and ask for the sake. They say that within Kufa, a woman looks towards Sakina, Ruqayya, right? Four-year-old. She sees blood on her face and she sees her hair all devilish. And she takes dates and she takes them towards Sakina. And she says, have some sadaqah. Sakina looks up and she says, it's haram sadaqah upon us. She says, then take it as a gift anyway. But you know what? Before you take it, do a dua for me. He says, what is that dua? Say, pray that my children don't become yatim in the same way as you were yatim. You know what Sakina does? At that moment, the tradition says she looks towards her aunt Zainab. And she says to her aunt Zainab, Zainab, tell me. Aunt Zainab, tell me. Says that Saleh was a prophet. And Qawm al-Samud, he says, Saleh was a prophet. He had a she-camel, right? That she-camel was killed by the people. The calf of the she-camel went to a mountain and prayed to Allah to take revenge. Now you tell me, am I worth more than that? Say that Zainab replies, says, you're worth more than that. She lifted up her hand. She says, I will pray against them. You say, Ameen. At that moment, say that Zainab says, look towards the head of your father and look at the tears that have come into the eyes of your father. Says Sakina then stopped. Said, if my father doesn't want it, then I won't do that. For that moment that Sakina's heart dropped, may Allah accept all of our hajat. May Allah accept the life, protect the life, the property, and the izzah of all of the followers of the Ahlul Bayt, wherever they are in the world. May Allah hasten to the Hur of the Imam alayhi salam and make us all part of his ansar. Wa sallallahu ala Sayyidina Muhammad wa alihi tahirin. Matam Hussein.